selections are upon us. If only that implied that reflection was upon us. I'm sitting here worried about who's next up in this office.
Was said this was locker room talk. I'm not proud of it. I apologize to my family. I apologize to the American people. Certainly, I'm not proud of it.
That was a mistake, and I take responsibility for using a personal email account.
Repealing all of the executive orders that Barack Obama has signed that are stifling economic growth in this economy.
Donald Trump wrote a book, and he said Social Security is a Ponzi scheme.
But you come in from China, you see these incredible airports, and you land, we've become a third world country.
How do we have better public policy that's based on empirical evidence rather than anecdotes?
What will you do to make sure that the U.S. meets the agreements from the Paris Climate Accords? And how will you make sure that those benefits from greener energy and more environmentally friendly practices don't only benefit the most privileged among us?
How will you boost resources to America's mental health services? And how will you guarantee equal access for everyone?
Studies show that when parents can spend more time with their children, we see better outcomes. What are your plans to improve paid parental leave?
And my question for the presidential candidates is, how are you going to improve the provision of care for mental health as well as reduce the stigma surrounding it?
What will you do as president to those who are stuck in the middle, making too much money to receive federal subsidies, but also not being able to afford the rising costs of healthcare?
What will you do to make sure that everyone has access to science education? Not just young people, but adults as well.
Today, a victory for evidence-based politics, with California Governor Jerry Brown signing a mandatory school vaccination bill that eliminates a personal belief exemption.
So this is why we're in favor of science, because science saves lives.
Welcome back. Another panel for you. And when you see the credentials of the five panelists we have here, I'm even less qualified to be on this panel. So I'm going to try, my last intro is way too long. I'm going to try to step to the side. They know what they're talking about. I'm going to try to get to them as soon as I can. But I do want to talk about, very briefly, a statistic that Jade pulled for me. And it was the percentage of the population that wants political candidates to have at least a basic understanding of science, which doesn't seem like a high bar. And it was 87% of all Americans. And thankfully, it was actually fairly consistent across ideologies. It was 92% of Democrats, 90% of Republicans, 79% of independents. I don't know why they don't care as much. That lowers my respect for independents even more than it was when I was a political scientist. But that is, I think, a good sign. But do all of the candidates have a basic understanding of science? If you just watched the debates and if you just watched their appearances on cable news and you just watched the Sean Hannity town halls, you might never find out, actually. But it does matter. And I think in the panelists responding to some of these questions, you're going to find out why, because we're going to be talking about some of the most consequential topics and areas where government can interact with our life for good or for ill. And so without further ado, I want to get to the panel. Some of these qualifications. Winner of the Nobel Prize for Physiology and Medicine, director of National... No. Oh, no, you're awesome, too, and we're getting to you.
Next year. It just was announced.
Thank you.
Director of National Cancer Institute under President Obama and director of National Institutes of Health under President Clinton, Dr. Harold Varmus. Welcome to the panel. Congratulations. Former New Jersey congressman and president of the American Association for the Advancement of Sciences, Rush Holt. Probably immune to some of the criticisms of elected officials that we've given so far tonight, I imagine. You've done well for yourself, sir. let's see. President and CEO of Research America, Mary Woolley. Welcome to the panel as well. American urban revitalization strategist, founder of Sustainable South Bronx, public radio host, and original TED speaker, Majora Carter. It's not written here, but I mentally put in extremely busy lady. You've been keeping yourself busy. And also a New York Times environmental journalist and senior fellow for environmental understanding at Pace University, Andrew Rivkin. Welcome to the panel as well. So in the intro, I was talking about the debates, and they're coming up soon. And so I want to give all of the panelists an opportunity to at least hypothetically place yourself as a moderator. We have people on this panel who are experts in health and medicine, experts on the environment. if you were sitting at the table and you were a moderator and you had an opportunity to ask a question of Donald Trump and of Hillary Clinton and no other candidates, because for some reason we stop it right there, what question would you like to ask to the candidates, to each of you?
Yes, so I'd like to ask, so if you become president, whomever, what would you do to put science and innovation to work to drive towards solutions to what ails us in this nation, ranging from energy challenges to health challenges, transportation, education? What would you do? Be specific.
Be specific is a good thing to throw on at the end. Yeah, they still won't be specific, but at least people will take note of it. What do you think?
Oh, gosh. I guess first would be that there's social science that shows powerfully that behind all the yelling about global warming, which is really fundamentally divides people, there's unbelievable congruence on energy innovation, energy investment in renewables. Yale did this study that shows there's basically no red and blue map. It's unbelievable. I wrote this piece about no red and blue states when it comes to clean energy and even regulating CO2. So I'd ask the candidates, why do you think the world is missing that point that we all care about clean energy when all you hear about is division?
Yeah, yeah. And actually, a little bit later on in the panel, we're going to get into the ways that even with something like clean energy, they attempt to frame it in a way to get people to think about it in different ways.
Yeah.
What do you think, sir?
Well, it would be a follow-up question to anything that came up in the debate. And that follow-up question would be, what's your evidence? A couple of us actually wrote an op-ed that appeared in the St. Louis Post-Dispatch before the St. Louis debate. And we said, if, say, economics comes up, and the candidates, as they always will, give ideological assertions, pre-baked ideas, the follow-up should be, isn't economics supposed to be an empirical science? What is your evidence?
Yeah. The novels of Ayn Rand, I think, for some of them.
And you could do the same thing on public health. You could do the same thing on climate change. You could do the same thing on evolution and investment in medical research or GMOs or whatever it is.
I'm going to be waiting just to hear the word evidence used. Not even in that context, I'll take it in any case.
Yeah. You've had three good answers, and my ambitions are perhaps not quite as high as my three colleagues to my right. And what I'd like to know is whether these folks who are running for president have a sense of the importance of science for their administration. I'd like to know whether they can tell us how they're going to make science an important part of the decisions they make, and secondly, how they're thinking about the future of the scientific enterprise. Because one of the things that I'm concerned about, whether we're discussing immigration or education, is the potential for a real fall off in our potential as a country to produce the kind of science we've been producing over the last couple of decades.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna speak for Joe Sixpack. Oh, no, that was the last time around. But anyway, there's somebody like that now. It's basically, let's just assume that there are these incredibly innovative opportunities in energy conservation and all that good stuff. How are we going to make sure that Joe Sixpack actually gets jobs in those fields?
Yeah. And that's an interesting way to frame it on jobs, as we've talked about, but in a way that I think it'll be a little bit more salient to some of the voters. Yeah,
I agree.
Yeah, we haven't heard an equivalent of the Joe Sixpack.
No, but
it seems like over the past few weeks, the equivalent, and there's no convenient name for it, but it'd be women who won't stand for the minimization of sexual assault. I think they might swing the election, actually. Perhaps, we'll see. And so we're going to go really early into the audience. We have a question. Sarah Kumar, you have a question you'd like to ask?
So earlier this year, President Obama and Vice President Joe Biden launched the Cancer Moonshot Initiative to make a decade's worth of cancer research advancements in 5 years. How is this initiative adding on to the current approach for cancer research? And also, what advice would you give to the next administration on continuing the momentum that has been generated so far?
I'm a fan of the moonshot for the following reason. It doesn't make any false promises, doesn't say we're going to cure anything by a certain date, doesn't specify certain cancers. It says we can make progress faster if we do certain things in a more efficient way. So I think it's absolutely true that science can operate faster. We can achieve things more rapidly if we have more money, which the moonshot has yet to provide, by the way, and we can do things better if we're more open with each other as scientists, working more efficiently across the traditional boundaries between the private sector and the government sector, being more open about our about sharing data, getting our results that are ready for distribution into the public domain through new publication practices, gathering scientists to share data and work collaboratively in teams. And I think he's both the president and the vice president have done a good job in making clear to the public that we've made some very significant advances in cancer research in the last 5 or 10 years, and there are some definite ways to both move those into the clinic more efficiently and also to take the lessons that have been learned and make investments in basic science. I don't think we're looking at a fundamental change in the kind of questions that are being asked, and I don't think we need to make that change because I think in general we're on the right track. But the practice of science is going to be more efficient, and having the public see that our national leaders are supportive of those efforts is critical to not only what we do, but what many other scientists do.
Yeah. This is perhaps a question for Dr. Holt, but we'll see. Anyone can jump in, of course. We've seen over the past year quite a few instances of where the private generation of medicines can have a bad impact, where life-saving treatments all of a sudden, I'm assuming, become much more effective because they become much more expensive. And that's you've seen that with the EpiPen. There was treatments for toxoplasmosis that overnight would go up 10 times, 100 times in price. And I wonder, do you believe that the president, that the government is doing enough to ensure access to, not even theoretically, but life-saving treatments and medicines? Is there more that the government could be doing? Is there a big role for the government in this area?
Well, you know, there are many parts to this. It's the research that can lead to the cures, to the improvements, to the improved quality of life. There is the efficiency of production and distribution. There are questions of fairness and equity. So I'm not quite sure what you're asking there. The president, the federal government, has a role in all of those.
Yeah.
In seeing that the research is done. Sometimes corporations will do it because they see a market, but much of what needs to be done won't be done that way. Yeah. That's where the NIH comes in. And we should remember, you know, when I was in Congress and somebody would come to me asking for more funding for their family disease, I would say, fine, I support more funding. We're nowhere close to diminishing marginal returns on investment in research. I mean, we could increase our national spending, on public and private, on research and development by not 20 or 30%, but 2 or 3 times, and not run into diminishing marginal returns. So I say to him, sure, I support more research there, but you have to promise me that as you go around lobbying on the Hill, you will also ask for more funding for the National Science Foundation, because it's there that the instrumentation, the methodology, and the students, the future researchers, get their training.
Yeah, and that then filters up to not just one family of diseases, as
and,
you put
and,
it, but
and
to
so
all of them.
So then the president has a role to see that the medicines are distributed fairly and affordably, you know, all that too.
Could I just jump in for 1 second on this drug price question? Because it's important to distinguish between the two examples you pointed out, which are generics, drugs that are off patent, and they are compensated
well established and
quite poorly, and the result is you end up with monopolies because most companies don't want to produce things that don't yield a profit margin. So I think there is some planning to be done here to ensure that the things that are under patent are competed for by having very large markets operate together. Getting Medicare in a position to force prices down is a very important consideration that is not currently in Medicare legislation. We could do that. And I think we could provide ways to support a larger profit margin for the generics so that there's more competition in that market. We don't end up, as we did in this case, with generic medications being suddenly charged for very high rates because they're the only source of very valuable commodities.
Yeah.
Could I just add too that you know your question framed this as what should the government's role be and so forth, and Rush Holt, you know, I think rightly said the government's involved in all of this. But I think we should also remember that we are the government. You know, we're the people who vote for representatives who have to struggle with these very complex issues, and it's really important that we not opt out, first of all, but that we. And that we not only vote, but that we speak up and say, here's my sense of what's going well and what is not going well. And I'd like to know if you're a candidate or if you now represent me, I'd like to know what your position is. How are you going to change this for the better? And that's how we get change in this country, is when the public demands it. And you see that over and over historically from patient groups demanding more attention to defeating polio, if we go back a ways, demanding that we move faster to find an answer to HIV/AIDS, to breast cancer, and Zika most recently. When the public demands it, that's when we get change. And that's the way it should be. That's the way this government is supposed to operate.
Yeah, and the examples that I gave were great cases of popular opposition to these moves, changing the pricing model for them. In one case, I believe, leading to the CEO of the corporation losing her position. But unfortunately, in some cases, once the media's eye is off of it, the assurances that we were given that the prices would go down, 6 months later, the coupons aren't available anymore, and people are once again being charged far more than they need just to stay alive. So I want to throw out this general topic. Feel free, anybody, to jump on it. Obviously, we want to see more good science being generated, but we also know that if a corporation wants to prove a point, there are unfortunately some PhDs that you can provide some funding for, and they will produce a study that will tell you pretty much anything you want, that sugar is good for you, or that the things we're pumping into the air don't have a horrible effect on respiratory diseases and things like that. And so how do we make sure that people are receiving the correct information, that they know how to look at claims that are being made. The area that jumps out to me is any kind of food product will have claims about heart disease and cancer, and we know that in many cases, those connections are incredibly weak at best. And so for people who cannot make science their livelihood and their life, as many of you have, how can we make sure that they filter information and make the right choices?
It's a real challenge. The one thing I've been thinking about a lot lately, I've been writing about science now for 30-something years, and I see these mythologies dominating on so many issues, from diet on to climate. And one thing that seems to be missing is a cultural thing. Like, what I wrote recently was, can we make reality cool again?
Reality.
No, seriously. I mean, do you want to be the kid who posts the picture of the 100-foot shark on Facebook, or the kid who knows it's wrong and here's why and points to it, you know, digitally? And somehow I think we still have this reaction that the kid who's like the nag is not the cool kid.
It's like he's correcting someone's grammar.
Exactly.
But he's not. It's more important than that.
And my blog, you know, I've kind of been like that kid quite a bit. Well, but, you know, and it's and I don't know. I don't know how good it is. And I think that transcends all of these arenas. How do you do that? A lot of it gets back to how we learn. Kids today, when we were kids, most of us, you know, you had to memorize things. And now, of course, you don't have to do that. It's all the knowledge is there. But you have to assess things. Like, a whole new skill set has to be emerging. Mm-hmm. In schools, if you want to even have the hope, like Snopes to me, I point to Snopes. If you don't know Snopes and you care about truth, then you're missing an opportunity to sort of share the truth. But they're overworked. Did you see there was recently an op-ed by a woman who works at Snopes.com, which is this reality-seeking tool on the web, which is
fact
a finger pointer.
Organization,
but they're completely overworked because it's like there's so much to do.
So you said hopefully people are familiar with it. In an election year, you have to be familiar with things like Snopes because Facebook becomes a minefield of misinformation.
Oh, God.
I hope so as well. And I've been waiting for a sign that culturally we've moved past this position of whether it's overt or not, the idea that the kid who wants to learn, the kid who wants to read, is a bad kid. And I think there's so many procedurals on TV of scientists and doctors. Hopefully we're moving past that a little bit, but I don't know for sure. Now, I want to turn back to a topic we talked about quite a bit in the first panel, and it has to do with the climate. I know many of you work in the environment. If you had to provide a grade for U.S. policy towards protecting the environment, the climate specifically, perhaps, how would you grade our current work that we've been doing as a country?
Well, this isn't my topic, climate. So I'd rather start with.
You live in the same environment as the rest of us.
I live in the same environment, and things don't look good to me. It's a low grade. Okay. Very low grade.
I think Obama deserves an A. I think he's done everything he could do, given the dynamics and the way Congress is so broken. I just think he's done great. And John Holdren, his science advisor, who somehow in his 70s held forth for 8 years, the longest serving science advisor, has helped to bolster him. Beyond that, it's pretty tough. And I think I wasn't happy. And I write an opinion. My writing moved to the opinion side of the Times 6 years ago, so I can say things that actually. I just want to be sure that's clear. I think Bernie was overdoing it with some things he was saying about global warming that didn't help the situation, and it built this division between him and Hillary that I think could have been avoided. But I don't expect, I know we live in a society where everyone has a role to play, and that's his role. The media, of which I've been a part for a long time, has this really bad habit when they're covering politics, and this is not just climate, but of focusing on the horse race. Well, like the climate bill in 2009, they're winning, they're losing. What's the strategy? How are they going to get the votes? As opposed to what would this actually do or not do to limit global warming? And if you looked at it with that lens, which we rarely do, you realize it was extremely limited what it would have done. And the growth in these greenhouse gases is overseas. 98% of the growth in emissions is not here. So figuring out ways to facilitate energy change elsewhere is a prime obligation. So it's kind of, that's where we're at. It's ugly sometimes.
So good for Obama specifically, but overall perhaps not. Yeah.
I think there's one thing that he missed a little bit. So I'd give him a firm B+, which is the fact that I think we waited too long to even start thinking about how do we adapt to the change in climate. And actually using that as an opportunity to really help educate the public about how they can be involved in that. Because again, I keep thinking about how much time was spent on trying to get a climate bill passed, in the Congress that we have. It's like, right, that was going to happen that way. And but I think that if it had been linked instead to how do we create, not to use the WPA or anything like that, but how do we literally rebuild, and make sure that America is great as far as dealing with resiliency issues around the changing climate? You could have connected that to jobs. You could have connected that to the new development of industries, and people would have seen that as like, oh, I could be a part of that. And instead, what we got is, folks, even though they talk about how important climate change is, and knowing that it's so far removed that I don't think it's really hit people in their hearts and minds, and I think we've lost so many people as a result of that.
I'll be brief here, but just I do agree with your point about remediation and preparing for climate change, and I also agree with many. I'm more on your side in evaluating the president. I think we also have to think about what it's going to mean to control emissions, and that means explaining our alternative energy sources. Advocating for more energy research, talking to our partners internationally about how they, and that means especially China and India, are going to help to control the emissions that are producing greenhouse gases.
Yeah, I think the president gets high marks working against long odds. As for Congress, I guess I'd say Congress dropped out 3 weeks into the semester.
That's a great. I was talking about Congress,
and now they don't even show up most weeks.
Well, and of course, what really bothers me is for climate change, for vaccination, for teaching evolution in the schools, for so many of these issues, we've walked away from the evidence. I mean, I'll come back to that. I was in Congress for 16 years. I really. Proud of what I did there, but I really thought that I might be able to do more, helping to bring the public back to where they were in previous decades and centuries, building a reverence for evidence. Mm-hmm. The real problem with climate change is my colleagues in Congress and my constituents, I was with a student a day or two ago who said, do you believe in climate change? And I say, it's not a matter of belief. And we won't be able to deal with that issue. We're not going to be able to deal with public health. We're not going to be able to deal with any of these other issues if they become questions of which ideological side are you on? What, you know, what is your belief?
Yeah. Can I ask him a question?
Yeah. You can't help.
I'm going to get a drink.
So what was it like being a physicist in Congress?
Yeah.
You know, like, Mr. Reality, basically. You know, I'm an opinion writer at the Times, and my opinion is reality matters. Yeah, right. But that's in a newspaper. It's hard there. But what they must have been, like, how did that...
You use a different part of the brain.
I mean, oh, okay.
Yes, I was a teacher and a researcher previously. I've now moved to the American Association for the Advancement of Science because I think advancing science for the benefit of all people, that's our mission, is really valuable, probably more valuable than some of the legislation that isn't being passed. But what was it like?
Can you think of any, was it some nightmare moment when you had a conversation with someone?
An illuminating moment was when anthrax spores were sent through the mail, a few offices were contaminated, my colleagues came to me and said, you're a scientist, tell me about anthrax. And I scratched my head wondering where in the physics curriculum I missed that part about Bacillus anthracis, right? Actually, I do know pores and envelopes and how spores can leak just out of an envelope. Right. But they were saying something really important. They were saying, you're a scientist. Right. You must know facts and figures. That's what science is. Yeah. In their mind, science is technology and a lot of Latinate and Greek words, and then some equations thrown in. And they also were saying, and I'm not. They're saying, you're a scientist, I'm not, I can't deal with those issues. And what we have to do is empower people, some of whom will be elected to Congress someday, to recognize that they too can deal with evidence. Yeah. They too can think like a scientist. They too can build a reverence for evidence and how it's collected and how it's curated and how it's analyzed and how it's communicated.
But that story brings up a very important point, which I think we need to address. That we're never going to have 100 physicists in Congress.
Right.
But every congressman should have scientists in their office.
That they trust in the system.
Yes. At our graduate school, we're training a lot of people who want to be academic scientists someday, and most of them are not going to be, because we're in a situation where the ability to support academic science has diminished, and we have a lot of people who are well-trained to think scientifically, to evaluate evidence, who can and will be doing other kinds of jobs, and we need to be sure our embassies have scientific attachés, that our congressional offices, that the executive branch is well populated with people who can bring evidence to people who have the power.
Yeah. I'll get a plug for AAAS. Every year we place 260 PhD level scientists in all branches of the government for a year as science fellows.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's not just that they're there to bring scientific expertise and be able to interpret the equations or the Greek terminology. They're there to recognize when science is embedded in an issue where the non-scientists don't even realize that there's a matter of science here.
Yeah. And that's almost every issue.
Right. That's right.
There's a role for scientists to play in election time too. Now it's late in the game. But for scientists to just take it on themselves to call candidates running in their district or in their state for Senate and say, I'd like to volunteer to be on your scientific advisory committee, to which some volunteer on the other end of the phone will say, well, we don't have one. And then say, I will help you set one up and carry through on that. Because we know that candidates for office, if they start talking about an issue and are invested in it,
and speak to it at every, as part of their talking points at every town hall, they are very likely to keep talking about it and to do something about it when they're in office.
Yeah, I know that the recently there was that big letter of the Nobel laureates and other PhDs who came out, but basically against Donald Trump and on the issue of climate, which I think that's an important role that scientists can play. But as you say, it doesn't have to be simply being an attempted veto on a candidate. It can be a supportive position as well.
Yeah. There's one
to make it normal to have science advisors.
Exactly.
There's one thing I want to raise as kind of a critique of science right now, which I know a lot of scientists are actually grappling with, and it's. The institutions of science, particularly the academy, I'm a professor now too, so I've seen this up close. You're not rewarded for doing science that's relevant to struggling poor people in sub-Saharan Africa, as much as you're rewarded for getting a paper in a high-impact journal about some new frontier thing that you got figured out.
Yeah.
And there's this Future Earth effort that's designed to try to torque more science toward applicability. There was this great paper, 1997, Dan Kamen, brilliant guy, and another one, Michael Dove, they wrote a paper called The Virtues of Mundane Science. Yeah. In other words, what can science do for the South Bronx? What can science do for water resilience in other parts of the world?
Yeah, making crops more resilient.
And it's the institutions that I think have an issue still, whether we have to sort of, the elders need to kind of like move away and so another generation younger than everyone here can take over, I don't know.
Well, you know, I'm really glad that you switched to the question of applicability and taking some of these theories and actually trying to improve people's lives. So this question is going to be for you, Major. I want to switch gears a little bit. So you're our sustainability expert, a lot of experience in the South Bronx. So in terms of sustainability projects, the attempts to actually improve people's lives and change things, in your experience, what has worked and what hasn't worked? And these experiments that have been done, if you were to spread them more broadly across the country, what sort of effect could that have? How much value could that have? I know there's a lot there.
That's okay. It's actually a nice segue from Andy's point, because what works are really very practical, on the ground, meaningful projects that have a direct impact to the people who need that, period. But what was interesting was just this last week, I got a chance to speak at the Yale University there, the environment and school, which was, you know, produced some of the most amazing folks that work in the environment around the country. And I was talking specifically about how the work that I've done is the same work. It's still in sustainability, but it is literally transitioned from specifically the environment to how to use, you know, the writ large, the development of a community, from the economic and the environment and the social all together to create the kind of world and communities that we want to live in. And I was inundated, literally, with requests from these grad students who were just like, that can happen. And it was just like, yeah, but you don't separate the environment from the social, from the economic. And that's what got them so excited, because they saw a practical application of the work that they were doing around the environment and sustainability as a way that to bridge what they felt was really important and what was missing, in this world.
Yeah.
And it was, I felt more hopeful than I have in a really long time as a result of that. Yeah. So yeah, it's starting, it's happening in a really great way.
Yeah. No, and it's great to hear the eye-opening moment for the young leaders of tomorrow.
They're so cute. They're so adorable.
Yeah. And when they see that their work could actually have a direct impact.
Yeah.
I unfortunately left my doctoral program before having that moment, unfortunately. They failed me. Now, we were probably going to return to some of these topics, but I want to make sure that we get to some of the audience questions first. So we have a question from Michael Halpern, the Union of Concerned Scientists. If we could.
Hi there. I want to talk about Flint. Where we saw information, scientific information, being held from the community for months by all levels of government. And we see this happening on all kinds of issues. We see the neighborhood of Manchester in Houston, where people are living next to chemical refineries and oil refineries, and they don't get information about what they're being exposed to. We see this happening in a number of different communities with coal ash in North Carolina, and all around the country. Where science is not serving people, and where the public health protections aren't working for everybody. So what does the next president need to do to make sure that all people have access to scientific information that allows them to advocate for themselves?
Well, anyone can jump in.
Okay, for one thing, if a new president, and for that matter, new members of Congress, raised science and the evidence that we need from science to the level of priority in this country that we reserve for things that are absolutely interdigitated with science, but say it explicitly. So health, the environment, every aspect of your life, really, transportation, education, talk about science as part of that. And then make sure in the budgets that they direct the OMB to produce and that agencies have to prepare and so forth, have enough money in them to provide the service to citizens of this country that they want and deserve. Yeah. Right now, those agencies are starving for adequate resources. They're playing a version of whack-a-mole. You know, whatever's on fire has to be dealt with, but meanwhile, we're starving other efforts.
It would also be great if our next president, whoever she is, makes a decision to, especially for some of the more historic places where this has continued to happen, that frankly they'd be made an example of, and not just, just you know, like that. A little teeny little fine, but literally, how do you take those some of the dollars that there's you to spend on something and actually really invest them in that community? One, to clean up, mm-hmm. and two, to rebuild and restore.
Do you think the story about Flint has been an object lesson? Is it going to have effects next time we have an episode of lead pollution in the city waters?
If folks are made to undo the damage, which it sounds so silly at this point, but if there was some real remediation and support for the city of Flint.
Much of what we're talking about is transparency and you can get it, and the data was there. So
it was totally there.
Is that enough, or do we need additional safeguards that are embedded in legislation?
I think if you actually made an example of stuff, it would be harder. I think it would really be harder for people to decide to act that way. Yeah, but we don't make it. We make it so easy for that kind of crap to happen.
Yeah. And one of the real lessons of Flint was that we needed whistleblowers. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't need whistleblowers. Science done right is open, democratic, small d. It you know, it is not just a special interest group. It is public. It has to be public to be done right, and ultimately, even as if corporations or selfish or arrogant scientists try to bottle it up, ultimately, the truth comes out. Yeah. It comes out sooner if the high standards of good science are observed all along. And so a scientist who works for a regulatory agency, let's say the Michigan Environmental Protection Agency, would be allowed to speak. That's the way it should be.
And in the end, it took outside scientists coming in.
Shouldn't have to have a whistleblower.
Yeah. But there is one promising element in here, both in that and the VW disclosure, in a website in Pennsylvania called fracktrack.org, which was created by some junior employee in 2009 in Pennsylvania legislature who knew that the government data on thousands of wells was there. He knew that the license information was there, who had the license to do that. But it wasn't available, so he created a website in like 2 days to put it all out there. So this idea that you, and Flint, there was a mother, a very determined mother, who found a lab willing to test water. Yeah. And social media played a role in that as well. So this, the connectivity, of course, I'm a communicator, so I'm biased toward the possibilities of communication making all this more possible. Infrared cameras, you point an infrared camera at a methane leak, and you see black clouds because it's opaque to infrared. And that's a cheap device overall. So communities, I don't think it's up to, you know, government has to play a role here, but don't wait for government. Yeah. There's so much empowerment now to get the information out and where it's needed. VW was like, you know, this tiny little NGO paid a little bit of money to this West Virginia University team, and they actually tested the actual emissions for an actual car. And, you know, it didn't match the computer, and oops, billions of dollars of
The fraud. The fake of a company, possibly. Yeah.
So there is hope.
And I've seen those the infrared maps of methane leaks in Los Angeles. They're scary.
Oh, the Aliso Canyon was a perfect example. EDF did the aerial video of that.
It's everywhere.
I guarantee you, that speed is the response.
And I'd like to add on to what Majora was saying about Flint, about the making an example. I think you won't have people not making these sorts of choices purely to save $100 a day or something like that on treatment chemicals until people are made an example of. It doesn't make sense to me, and this is me as a non-scientist, so, and a non-lawyer as well. It's never made sense to me that if you were to poison one child with lead on purpose, you go to jail. If you poison 9,000 kids, you get shuffled to a different department. That seems weird, but that's how America works, unfortunately. People should be in jail.
I agree. Yeah.
And then remember, it's not just the lead. There's also the, and it's not as confirmed, but the Legionnaires cases, and people actually died as a result of that. We don't know for sure that it was a result of the decision that was made, but people died.
Yeah.
Usually when people die, someone's responsible.
Yeah.
Now, we also have another question from Nancy Knowlton from the Smithsonian.
A lot of environmental science is pretty depressing, and I can't say that I'm blameless. My husband and I used to be called Doctors Doom and Gloom on the lecture circuit. But I and other environmentalists have increasingly come to feel that we need to talk more about the science of success and solutions rather than the science of despair. And in response to that, the Smithsonian is actually hosting the first Global Earth Optimism Summit next April. On Earth Day weekend. And so my question for the panel is, what stories of success, specific stories, do you think we should feature? And also more broadly, how can we get the public to realize they can actually make a difference?
Well, let's talk about the Golden Goose Awards. In response to congressional ridicule of some funny sounding research, a group of science societies, AAAS now heads this up, gives annual awards to federally funded research that has been ridiculed, that turns out to be really important, like the sex life of the screwworm fly. You might imagine that was ridiculed. It turns out to save ranchers billions of dollars because we've learned, the researchers learned that you could release sterile males and wipe out an entire generation and therefore a whole population and stop this thing that kills cattle. Another study, social science, was a longitudinal study of risky teenage behavior. It was ridiculed on the floor of Congress because they asked questions about sex. And it turns out to be really important, not just about teenage behavior in some of these taboo areas, but actually they've learned a lot about early onset heart disease from that longitudinal study. So the Golden Goose Award is a nice way of turning the tables on these skeptics. But I mean, there's such a long list. A sense of history will tell you that, you know, we now understand how our physical world works, ocean currents, atmospheric currents. We know where we're going in climate change. We understand how bacteria protect themselves against viruses, and we've learned how to use that very technique. We've learned about immunology. And in social sciences, there have been real advances in social and behavioral sciences. I mean, I think you could fill a week with good news from science.
One of the most important ways for us to look at the future of science is to look at the past of science and to look at things that are improving our lives now and see where they came from. The National Academy has put out a bunch of papers, very short, digestible essays about where the great triumphs of science have come from. And the origins, while not perhaps always worthy of a Golden Goose Award, nevertheless represent a defense of basic science, which I think is very important, especially in medical sciences at the moment, where the potential dividends are so great that everybody wants to invest the spare dollars we have in the next step, which is going to deliver clinical benefit. If we don't have a balanced portfolio, making investments in the kind of science that was the Rush just alluded to, the
the ability of bacteria to defend themselves against virus, which has produced this new gene editing technique called CRISPR. That is a recent example of something which is going to pay enormous dividends in the future. Going back and looking at how that's happened in the past is a very instructive exercise in the social and natural sciences.
By the way, there's the media and environmental groups need to do some more of that looking as well. I've looked at my own career, and through 30 years of writing about climate change, I definitely have been focusing more mostly on
the
scenarios that are the worst case outcomes. And the IPCC, the climate panel, their job was to identify the worst case outcomes. But then when you look at, like, let's look at sinking islands. We've all heard this relentless narrative of small islands going under in rising seas, and it makes total sense. But there's a scientist in New Zealand, a geographer who's been studying hundreds of small islands in the Pacific in an area where the sea level is rising actually faster than the global average. And over the last 100 years, these islands actually, they're dynamic systems, and they keep up with sea level rise. You don't hear that. Because it's kind of like, sell that in the newsroom. Sell that in the newsroom. And by the way, the inconvenient part of that story is, I've been to some of these islands where they've developed heavily, and they're developed right to the shorelines, you know, and they're like Mali, the capital of Maldives, has 1 square mile. It looks like Manhattan in the middle of the Indian Ocean. Just boom, 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 boom. And it has no dynamic. It can't be dynamic because there's no shore anymore.
It's been encrusted by humanity.
It's built right to the edges. So there's a great narrative story to tell about, you know, not just the woe is me. And by the way, most island residents don't want to leave their homes.
Yeah.
So finding ways to tell the stories of, well, how can we develop a resilience planning mechanisms for islands that give you resilience and dynamics, let you have that softer development pattern. And by the way, Manhattan eventually will need the same kind of thing because it's built right to the edges. And guess what? Sea level's rising for centuries to come, barring some huge geoengineering miracle.
Yeah.
And
so I've seen those images, the projections.
Right?
Of what
and they're mostly
like.
Soft, right? They're mostly green. And we got to tell those stories too.
So you know, this point that we've made a lot of progress, in fact, that we are so eager all the time to live in the moment or the next moment and forget about progress. But to continue to make that kind of progress, we've got to invest in the young generation of people who want to be scientists, want to get a scientific education, and then go to work tackling these problems. But that isn't, in fact, what's happening right now. We've made it extremely difficult, way too competitive, given the challenges that are out there. And part of the solution to getting more young people into science is the rest of us demanding it, because it's in our interest, frankly.
TYT did a piece on the plight of the postdoc recently. It was actually a pretty depressing segment.
A lot of ours are, to be fair.
You know, it's a call to us to actually do things about it. We should pay them better. We should, you know, give them a future, remind them that they have a future. They don't have to be like their advisor. In fact, they might be better off if they weren't like their advisor.
Exactly. So. Not like that. You know, I love the question that you brought up, because Jade provided a question that takes a bit of a step back, and it is a little bit more optimistic, so I like this one. So. This is way broader, but from each of you, what do you think the greatest scientific advancement in history is? And if you'd like, what can the next president learn from it? I'm not grading you. It can be just one that it perhaps affects your work or you found personally inspiring as you were coming up in the field. What do you think are noteworthy scientific advancements? And you don't have to go in strict order if someone already has them.
Isn't Darwin's great-grandson in the audience? I mean, how could I not vote for Darwin?
Very good.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that if it is President Trump, he could learn something from Darwin, actually, and the rest of the party, perhaps.
Especially that he sang to worms. Darwin did.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, or he made music, right?
Yeah.
Any other suggestions? Greatest advancement?
Too rich in
it. Yeah, it's just too broad.
That's a difficult one.
You know, I think of Galileo rolling things down an inclined plane. He realized that if you actually measure how long it takes these different masses to go down the same plane, you could learn a lot about gravity. And you can learn, if you learn a lot about gravity, then you can learn a lot about tides. If you learn a lot about tides, you can learn a lot about fisheries. You can, it's the idea that asking questions so that they can be answered empirically,
through evidence,
communicated openly, and then validated through a competitive, critical peer process, that's science.
Yeah. That's actually another version of a story I often tell, told me first by a renowned biochemist who said, science began when some caveman wondered how long it took for a rock to drop from his hand to the ground. Yeah. And the point of that is that the implicit in that question is measurement. And measurement, of course, is evidence. And one thing we've not talked too much about today is we've talked about ideas, but not so much about quantitation, about numbers. And I think that's an important thing, getting embedded in our curriculum a better sense of how you make estimates, how you judge the risk of something, how we make a more numerate culture than we currently have.
Yeah.
And then it really comes back to a measurement, which is basically a development of a technology. And technology and science are not, you know, we say science and technology, but actually the science I do is totally dependent and having the technology that allows us to make measurements that inform our thinking about the natural world.
So with Galileo's inclined plane, that was the beginning of the reverence for evidence.
And by the way, Galileo, I'm writing this modest little book on the history of weather knowledge, like how some people at that time, centuries ago, came up with the idea of degrees. Actually, before the thermometer, you had to have the idea that there were degrees of change.
Yeah.
And I thought that's really cool. Wow.
What was it before?
It was warm.
Well, it was warm today.
There was a name for this.
How long is an hour? How many hours in the day? These things are critical.
Yeah, you have to measure.
How many months? Yeah.
And all of that, to me as an outsider, entirely nonsensical. I don't understand how they generated any of these measurements and made them standard across. I mean, I know now they have a block of some kind of metal in London or something like that.
We had a presidential candidate who was interested in getting the metric system into the U.S.
Remember
that?
Yes.
Didn't
do very well.
Can we get it into the New York Times? That's the question. It's still not.
So a little bit of optimism was good. Let's go back to potential pessimism. So we've returned time and again through both of these panels to the climate issue because it's an important one. Some people think that the continuation of our species would be a good thing, and that's a big obstacle to it, perhaps, in terms of not just affecting how we produce food, but also generating more civil war, more war between countries as resources become more scarce. Water wars could be something that we look forward to in the next half century. So as we're currently situated, government-wise and with the scientific understanding that we have, are we in a position to deal with these issues? How will we manage them? We know that some degree of climate change will continue, whether the Paris Accords are followed by all the states, whether we go a little bit further. How are we situated to deal with these threats to the current way things are?
Okay, so you mentioned the Paris Accords. I'd say that in terms of our future collectively in every respect, we've got to deal with the world. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to be
interconnected,
running toward opportunities to work with the rest of the world, not hunkering down in this country intellectually or in any other way. So that becomes something critically important for the next president and new members of Congress to take very seriously. And we've got to get past the day, and it exists still today, that many members of Congress don't have passports and literally have not been outside this country. And it's, you can read a lot about it and listen to a lot of experts, but there's no substitute for getting there yourself and finding out what other nations in the world can teach us, which is a lot.
Yeah, and would have benefits fully apart from climate change.
Oh,
so the experiencing
absolutely.
Other cultures and
absolutely.
Seeing other ways of life, other organizations of the economy.
Yeah.
We should go down to Majora.
Yeah, we have a hard time.
You're disadvantaged down here, don't we?
You're disadvantaged in life in general. sorry, it's been a long day. But anyway, we have a hard time, you know, seeing a mile outside of our homes. We don't need a passport. I mean, you know, Mr. Halpern was talking about the environmental inequalities that exist that we're still trying to reconcile. But I think ultimately it is going to have to be, how do we, you know, see ourselves, you know, as a country where there are a lot of different types of people. You know, the most vulnerable have actually not been supported, at least not on the climate, not on the sustainability, certainly not on the quote-unquote environmental front in any meaningful way that actually keeps pace with, you know, having a meaningfully good public health and environmental quality that we're dealing with around this country. So I think that's one of the first steps we've got to look. We do need to look inward, because we just don't look now at all. Unfortunately, I think that's the truth.
I'm trying to reconcile this local view with the global view. Right. I think it's important that people who are articulating for science, and when I look for a new president, I'm not expecting to find an academic chemist ready to walk into the White House, even though Margaret Thatcher, of course, was an academic chemist at one time. And what I'm looking for is someone who can say, here is why science is so important to every aspect of your life, and also point out that science is essentially a global activity. You think about whether it's developing a vaccine against malaria, or developing new treatments of cancer, or dealing with the Zika virus, certainly in the biomedical sphere, but also even perhaps more importantly, because it's an existential issue, in climate science, the scientific community has to work in a global fashion. And that opens the door to an awful lot of interactions among countries that I thought were well illustrated by what happened with the Paris Accord. I thought for a moment people said, no, this is existential for the human condition. And we have a remarkable degree of collaboration at the level at which scientists normally can collaborate. And getting politicians to say, these are scientific issues, have to be solved in the global sphere, that would be a huge step forward. And I think actually President Obama's been doing a pretty good job in making that apparent. He's had to deal with a lot of local issues, especially down the other end of Pennsylvania Avenue, that make it hard for him to get this done.
Hundreds of people there. Yeah, Paris is a weird thing, the Paris Agreement. It took us back to 1992. Rio, the original climate treaty, emerged in Rio, and it was voluntary, and it had the same aspirational quality. And we spent 20 years learning that you can't get nearly 200 countries to agree to something that's binding. It has binding targets and timetables and penalties. That's what ended in Copenhagen in 2009. Paris was finally circling back to soft diplomacy, getting people in the room, getting them to agree to come back every 5 years, and let's see how we're doing. But we're not going to do anything more than we could do, basically, politically, that we knew we could do. So in the atmosphere, you can take the atmosphere's point of view on what happened in Paris. It's completely insufficient, completely. Because everything in Paris was agreements from 2020 to 2030. And the decarbonization climate challenge is out here. Business as usual through 2100 is like this on emissions, and we have to go like that. And that's where science comes in. There were two different papers that said Paris, this going forward, the agreement has to have some kind of way for countries to get credit for investing in basic science related to energy again, and agriculture to feed that planet. As humanity is going to nine or so billion by mid-century, and everybody does not want to be cooking on charcoal, like in the Nairobi slum I was in a few months ago. They want to be cooking on LPG, you know, like my backyard grill, or something better. It's one of the great challenges of our time, is making that transition, but it's not a challenge we can do with the level of science investment we've got. Not just here. All the rich countries completely asleep at the wheel.
And to bring it back to something that former congressman was speaking about, it's interesting that you can have people recognize a threat and they want to turn to scientists. If it's anthrax spores, all of a sudden a scientist becomes Gandalf. Yeah. If it's in an envelope 100 yards from you, but if it's in the air around you, and if it's slowly changing our entire planet for some reason, even if there are thousands of Gandalfs around the world, nobody cares anymore. And that's a little bit depressing, unfortunately. One more depressing piece of information. We'll hopefully have something optimistic. So in the research that was provided for me from Jade, apparently the questions for the final debate have been made available to a source that said there is not a climate change related question in the third. So that means three for three, no climate change questions, unfortunately. And with all the videos that have been released about the activities of at least one of the candidates from the 90s, there's probably not going to be much policy discussed at all. But I would like to, so we always circle back around to what should be being discussed.
Quick comment on that. When we did the 20 questions, it wasn't just for the presidential candidates. Every political candidate, at least for national office, should get those questions.
Right.
That's a good point. Yes, and I'm so glad that you at least
do that.
Exactly. So, yeah, and by the way, great credit that you were able to get. Obviously, Donald Trump is the one that it's a little bit harder to get him to answer those, and he did his best to evade some of them. But even having the candidates down on some of these basic topics is so necessary. You can get them to sign no tax pledges and things like that for some reason, but when it comes to just acknowledging that reality is real, that's much more difficult. So for the remainder of the election, we might not have much discussion of climate change, unfortunately, but what science-based topic would you like to see at least one news cycle focus a little bit on before we go to vote in less than 3 weeks? What are some suggestions? And there's a lot of topics that we didn't even get to on this panel that was devoted entirely to these sorts of things. So a lot to talk about. What are your suggestions?
Well, talking about what ails us physically and mentally, our health challenges, could indeed be part of the conversation. There's plenty to talk about. There's also an effort called Campaign for Cures that is like the science debate questions, but only about medical and health related topics, and urging people who might be representing us, for all of us, to urge them to say something now about what they would do to assure we're going to have better health by putting research to work in both the public and private sector. And that can come through calling and talking to candidates. It can also come from calling and talking to talk radio, which exists everywhere. It can be on social media and can be directed at Chris Wallace.
Specifically.
Who is a mental health advocate, by the way, and might find a way to look.
And in my experience, occasionally responsible. Unfortunately, I've also heard his philosophy for fact-checking during debates, so I don't have very high hopes for this final one.
I'd say science education. I would ask, are you going to continue President Obama's remarkable string of having science fair at the White House every year? And I think Congress, why not have one at the Capitol? From what I understand, there is broad-based support for science. Even George Will, in 2010, George Will wrote a column saying, hey, new Republicans, don't forget science matters. And I wrote a piece about that at the time saying, keep it up, George. And then he didn't. And that's another thing. There is
you
this.
Jinxed it.
When it's not politicized, there is a tradition of support for science. But you go to a classroom. One of the most exciting things I've done as a reporter in all this time was in the Bronx High School of Science High School of Energy and Technology. Mind-blowing. The kids go in, they go into the boiler room. That's part of their curriculum, and they learn about their school as a system. And if systems thinking is the thing that we ideally
need
to work on.
Wait, they do it in science now?
Yes.
High School for Energy and Technology, and it was created by someone who moved into the mayor's office. She was the sustainability person for the New York City schools, and they got a grant.
Cool.
It's a great story. It might be too long for right now. I'll try to do it really quickly. they got a federal grant to put in new super cool like heating and cooling systems in New York schools that would be saving a lot of money. And then they talked to the union for the schools, and they said, we don't have people who can run those. So she said, we need to train people to run these. So they created one of these specialized high schools, High School for Energy and Technology. And go there. It's just amazing.
That sounds really interesting. I didn't know anything like that.
By the way, the custodian is their lecturer for that day. That alone is so rich. Cool. And then go to Governor's Island. Go to the Harbor School.
That's cool.
And the Harbor School, mind-blowing. It's kids from all over the city, 80% poverty rate families. And they're doing this Billion Oyster Project. They're New York Harbor is their laboratory.
Optimism science once again.
Absolutely.
We only have a minute or two left, so what are your suggestions? Science-based topics.
It's hard to find one thing that I want to devote time to. That social and behavioral sciences are sciences. That would actually be good. But how about devoting attention to what what standards need to be met for science to work right. You know, peer review, openness, and diversity. Diversity of the people doing science, not just so they have diverse perspectives and come up with better ideas, but so that if we're actually aiming to serve humankind, humankind is doing it.
Yeah.
I think these are all terrific things, yeah. But they're too easy to answer. Yeah. No one's going to say I'm not for medical research. No one's going to say I'm not for science education. No one's going to say that I don't want to be open with my science. Yeah. But I think more specific questions like, do you support nuclear energy? Yeah. Do you support do you support having a fund for emergency response to new virus infections? Do you support use of vaccines to protect the population? I think there are more
right.
pointed
That's
questions
right.
that will decide whether or not someone's actually thought about these things and are willing to step up to a controversial issue.
So right. Sure. Yeah, and I think I would go back to where I first started here, which is how are we going to use science to make America great again?
You might be able to get it solved then. If you frame it that way. So I wish that we had much more time. Unfortunately, that is going to be it for now. But great suggestions. And what's awesome is that right now, you guys can actually help to make that actually happen. Because not only can you tweet out at hashtag vote for the number 4 science with the topics you'd like to see discussed, the questions you'd like to see asked, but no climate change. That's not happening. Forget about it. But you can also go to sciencedebate.org and sign a petition that's currently ongoing to try to get more political candidates to be open about these issues, the ones that are a little bit easier to agree to, with and the ones that are a little bit harder, perhaps. But we got to start somewhere. And you can also go to ucsusa.org to find ways that you can take action on many of the topics that we've talked about today and generally when it comes to the intersection of politics and science. And so I want to thank a great panel. I didn't understand much of what you were saying, unfortunately, but hopefully the next generation will get all of it. No, it sounded great, though. And whoever becomes president, I have an advisory council in mind for them. So hopefully a round of applause for the awesome panel. The first panel as well. Jade, thank you so much for setting this up. Hopefully just one of many more to come. And YouTube for hosting. Thank you so much. Yeah. Also, the Young Turks, thank you. Oh, and by the way, if you are worried that this next debate will be, as Nomi said, the abyss, the Young Turks will be doing live commentary of the debate this coming Wednesday. I will be there, and I'll have alcohol nearby. Anyway, okay, thank you, everybody. This has been great. More politics and science. Let's hear it. Yeah.